Welcome to the good, the bad, and the sequel with your hosts, Doug and Jamie.
We are back, and this is the movie podcast where we're talking sequels and we do it in two parts. The first, an interview with an actor, someone involved that made the film worth watching, and the second, a discussion of the sequel, what they got right, what they got wrong, and how it could have been better. Really hope you enjoyed last week's interview with Jerry Wasserman. He is the gentleman in this film that gets his hand bitten off by the crazed dog. And that guy's awesome. He's been in over 200 films. And if you listen to the interview, great. If not, go back, because his story is so cool. He only got into acting because he had a crush on a girl. She tried out for a play. He did it. And the rest is history. He's been in everything, pretty much everything. You think of it, he was in it. But before we dive into this week's movie, or maybe fly into this week's movie, ooh, I have to introduce you to my partner in this sequel watching journey, Jamie Riccardi. Jamie, how you doing?
I'm feeling a little disturbed after watching this movie, Doug.
I gotta be honest. Good disturbed, like the album.
No, not the good disturbed. Almost emotionally disturbed. I mean, I'm kind of scarred. This is the first time seeing this movie, so this was an eye opener.
Yeah, did you see the first one?
Oh, of course, many times.
And this one just really kicks it up a little bit.
This one's a little different. This one definitely pulls on the emotional strings in some points.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll get into it. There's a lot to break down. But before we do, we have a guest this week. He was the one who helped us break down Leatherface, Texas Chainsaw Massacre 3, provided a lot of insight. He loves horror, so he had to come back for this. Chris Egan. Chris, how you doing, man?
Hey, Doug. It's awesome to be back, especially, you know, in this lockdown that we're all in.
Yes.
It's good to see a friendly face other than my wife, as much as I like looking at her, but you know, I'm glad to see you guys. And I'm super excited to talk about this movie.
Well, I think after staring at our faces, you're going to want to go right back to your wife.
Yeah. So The Fly 2, when we were talking like months ago, like I interviewed Jerry a while back, and I remember talking to Kristen. He's like, oh, I'd love to do that. And I just remember, this is like one of those movies I had on VHS, and man, we'll get into it, but man, there's some of these scenes that disturbed me as a kid, but now as an adult watching it, you know, at 4:30 in the morning, when my daughter was teething, it was pretty awesome. So we'll get started in it.
I watched this with my daughter, and she was bawling at one scene.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah, so we'll get to that.
I think I know which one.
I got news to you. I almost bawled. It was rough.
Yeah.
I was laughing because I was listening to last week's episode, and you mentioned that this movie scarred me as a child, but I think you were imprinting your own memories on me because I didn't see this till I was in like high school.
Okay.
But it did crack me up because, you know, there's stuff in this movie that definitely like messed with me even then.
Yeah.
I'm a huge fan of the original. So of course I've seen this one actually probably almost as many times, but it's been probably, you know, probably at least a solid 10 years since I watched it. So I was really excited to get back into it.
Nice. It was a really nice refresher. So the movie opens up. Now I haven't seen the first one in a while, but the original obviously happens at Bartok Industry, right?
No. I think they're either briefly mentioned or they're not mentioned at all.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Seth Brundle, who's Jeff Goldblum's character in the original, he mentions working for a company and, you know, he's doing like experiments offsite, like in his like giant warehouse loft apartment. But I don't know if Bartok's actually mentioned. They might be, but it's, you know, it's probably one of those just minor details that gets thrown out there.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I thought it was, but it took me a while to realize that was supposed to be Gina Davis, because they use a different actress. I mean, this movie, yeah. I mean, you don't see it too often, but this movie just jumps right in. I thought it was cool. You hear the buzzing noise of the fly right in the beginning. I'm like, all right, this is cool. You see the title and then no credits. And it just jumps. I mean, it doesn't waste any time.
Yeah. And it hits you not only with like horrifying, like emotional stuff, with a childbirth that's going completely awry.
Yeah.
And then it hits you with the immediately gross out monster stuff.
Oh.
And there's a part of me that like, when I'm watching that scene, you're like, you're into it. You're immediately into the movie. But then it like, as soon as you see it's not Gina Davis, it kind of pulls you out for a second.
Yeah.
But the emotional stuff definitely keeps it going.
And there's no explanation. I mean, like, you know, this, it just dives right into it. I mean, I was a little confused at first. I wasn't sure what was going on. I had no idea what this movie's about. So yeah. I didn't know, you know, I thought it was going to be like some regular sequel, you know, another guy turns into a fly. Like, I didn't realize what this is about. This is intense.
they knock you right in the face right in the beginning. But it's funny, these scientists, this is obviously the first time a fly creature gives birth. And they seem like it's so normal. And when he holds it up to Bartok, who's in like the observation deck, he holds it up almost like Simba in Lion King. And he just looks at it and they're like, oh, this is what it is. And then that's what I don't understand. Why is there a baby inside there? Why is that a cocoon? It's really just the outside of a fly, sort of.
No, I think it's supposed to be like a weird egg. It's like an egg sac thing that like an insect would lay, but then inside of it, because he's part human or even mostly human, he's like, you know, he looks like a human baby within that. But yeah, I don't know what's more disturbing, is that scene or the birth scene in the original. I think the birth scene in the original, but this is up there.
Wait, there's a birth scene in the original?
So real quick, in the original, when Gina Davis's character, she finds out she's pregnant in that movie. And she has a nightmare that she's giving birth to like a giant larva worm, which is why she's not in this movie, because she said filming that messed her up so badly that she was like, I can't do another.
I don't know why.
Gross out. She's like, I can't do another gross out fly monster birth scene. And that's why she's not in it. That's literally the only reason.
So, well, you know, they didn't even try to find someone that looks like her either. I mean, again,
I did notice there's this scene where she's like crying. It's like right before she starts to die. And the camera is like at her feet looking up at her. And there's a weird angle where she kind of looks like Gina Davis. I was like, I see what they were going for. I see that they kind of knew what they were doing. But yeah, for the most part, you're like, oh, it's not Gina. Bring back Gina.
You know, there's one thing that I see occurring a lot in this movie. There's a lot of death. And there doesn't seem to be a lot of remorse. Like, no one seems fazed by anyone dying in this movie at all. Yep. Yeah. It's like they're so used to it. Like, all right, yeah, move on.
Yeah.
Or it's like these people don't have families, that they're like, oh my God, we have to break the news to, you know, Gina Davis's character, you know, not her, but that character died. Are they notifying people? Do people know who she is? Or is she an orphan or what?
I mean, in the first one, she's like a famous-ish reporter. She's got to have...
Somewhere.
I mean, we get you know, a little bit of what's his name, Stathis, who's also in the original. You get a little bit of him, who's like apparently her only connection.
Yeah,
maybe she's an orphan. I don't know. Maybe mom and dad, you know, passed on in the years between. But
and he's good, Stathis. He was in the thing I remember him from is Don't Tell Mom the Babysitter's Dead. He's like that really creepy like boss guy to Rose and Christina Applegate at that company. But yeah, so then we see that. And then, dude, the stages of the growth of this kid creature into Eric Stoltz is obviously makes sense because a fly, you know, the life cycle is so short. But with the kid, it's just, I don't know, it's just creepy, the whole thing.
I had some thoughts watching it this time around that I never really put together the first time. So we start off, it's this horrific birth scene. Mother dies, egg sac baby. Gross, right? Then we get this kid who's like living in a lab. He's a super genius. He's growing at an accelerated rate. It turns into like a weird Disney movie for like part of it. It's like, did you ever see like Daryl?
Yeah, of course.
Or like, you know, Flight of the Navigator, where the kid's living in the lab for like a extended amount of time. It reminded me of that. And it was a weird emotional whiplash that I had. And I never experienced that before. And I've seen this movie, you know, probably 10 times already.
But I was are flies supposed to be smart?
Well, I think it's supposed to be that Seth was a genius, his father, and Gina Davis's character was like an extremely intelligent reporter. And then you have like this accelerated fly. So he's like, everything's accelerated. I think that's what they were going for, because his father was supposed to be like one of the smartest men ever, basically. So I think they're playing on that, but you know, it works. It works for me in the context of the movie.
Okay. So let me ask you this. So in the first movie, he doesn't do a successful transportation, correct?
So it's kind of like this, where there's a bunch of test runs. They try, he tries like a baboon, and the baboon like explodes like a microwave. He tries steak. There's a really gross scene where he tries a steak and he runs it through, but when it comes out, there's something off about it. It looks all right. But when he tastes it, or Gina Davis tastes it, and she's like, oh, it tastes like synthetic, which is what gets his brain going. And he figures out like what to put in the computer to make it like realize like it's like it should be transporting organic, instead of just duplicating it.
So you know, I we're not there yet. This is definitely a hard, like, so why do they try with either a baboon and a dog instead of using like a mouse or like something, like, why are they using these like huge, you know, like,
yeah,
animals, they really try to tug at you.
I think the baboon, he mentions like he gets them from like the lab because they're doing tests on them anyway. and then of course the first successful run in the first movie he does on another baboon, and the baboon comes running out and like hugs him, and then that's when he decides to go in himself and try it. So in this it's a similar like trial and error kind of process. And then, you know, once he figures it out, he puts himself through.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. You mentioned how a few minutes ago about like the change of the film. And then later in this movie, it turns to a rom-com. There's like a good 15 minutes.
Yeah. There's weird
montage
phases.
And it's bizarre.
Yeah. There's weird phases to this movie.
How long do they know each other?
I think it's supposed to be like a few months. I think it's supposed to be. I know it's not presented like that, but
presented like it's like 3 days.
I thought it was a day. I thought it was like they met and then had sex the next day.
Because you're seeing them like hang out and work on the computer, and then you're seeing them like and then a couple scenes later they're having dinner together. Then there's a scene where they're dancing together. So I think it's supposed to be weeks, if not months.
Yeah, so you know, they don't. I agree with you, Doug. They don't explain it that well, and it
show
looks
a
like
calendar, a newspaper turn, or something. Give me something.
It reminded me of like Naked Gun when they go on like this long date of like a baseball game and travel the world, and they find out it's just one day.
Yeah. Well, you know, it would have been good if Daphne Zuniga's character—I can't remember her name right now.
Beth.
If she had like a big flat desk calendar and she's just crossing off the days that they're working on the project, you know, like something. You know, you could see weeks or months go by, but I you can kind of tell that's what's going on. But yeah, no, they definitely don't explain.
Like after they're dancing, show her cross off a day on the calendar. Then when they're pretending to fish,
or like a Christmas party or something. They go to that one party, but it's not for anything in particular.
Well, I also have a hard time not looking at her as Princess Vespa. I have to be honest.
I think these are the only two movies I've seen her in. I don't.
Well, she was in 90210. I mean, that's the only other thing that she was in, but yeah.
Yeah, I never watched that.
I didn't either.
Sure. So we'll get to when they meet in a little bit, but so Bartok, this kid's getting raised in like this lab. It's all set up like a kid's room sort of with some like scientific equipment, two-way mirror. They're just watching everything he does. And then Bartok like has everybody in the room and he looks at them and he says, "You listen to me, and I don't listen to no one. I listen to God." And then he wants to meet the kid. And this is the first time he ever met him. I think he's 11 months old. Because they're showing the chart. And he goes, "I want you to call me dad."
Yep.
It's like, wow, dude. Like,
there's a lot of creepers in this movie.
Oh.
I mean, he's one of them. The security guard is another one. We'll get to him later. But So what's his, I know he's trying to take over the world or something. Like what's his goal? Like what's his end goal that he's trying to do?
I do want to get to that. I think we should get to that a little later. Cause that really doesn't come up till the end of the movie.
Who, Bartok?
Yeah. The thing about him, like, he's like, "Oh, this is going to change the world. I'm going to rule."
Okay.
Yeah. But he said, so that part, but what he says earlier, which is kind of weird. He says that, and it makes no sense. He goes, "Once this technology," when he's trying to sell it on Martin, he says, "Then there'll be no surgeries needed."
Right.
And I don't understand how that would be if it's really just teleporting. How is that even like obviously he's selling him a story.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's somewhat tied to like the end of the movie about like getting, that's the other thing. Like if you have like an ulcer or something that needs to get worked on, the teleportation pod, I don't think is going to help you out. But if you have like a tumor, I think that's what he's getting at. Like, oh, you know, brain surgery will be a thing of the past because we'll be able to like teleport you across and remove the tumor in the process. It's really not.
You're not explaining it any better.
Yeah, I know. we'll just leave the tumor behind. All right. The tumor behind.
So then the kid has that emotional attachment when we see him get a little bit older. He's kind of a smart ass to the scientist. And then he wants to see Bartok.
Well, I mean, it's around the same time. What is that hat that he made?
It's from, it looks like it's the same one that Rick Moranis wears in Honey, I Shrunk the Kids. Exactly.
The Zelensky model.
Yes.
But does it do anything besides shoot water?
And voice change.
Oh, voice change.
Well, I like that. Like he does that and he's talking to the doc. He's talking to Dr. Shepard and he's like, well, does it do anything else? And he shoots him in the face with water. Yeah.
And I love that his thing. He's like, just do the maze so I can go home and do something more useful. It's like this kid's like one of a kind. And this guy doesn't want to be here. I'm sure he makes good money, Dr. Shepard. And then he does the maze really quick, hands it back. And he's like, brilliant. And then he just leaves.
There seems to be a lot of animosity towards a kid. I mean,
everybody hates him.
And he's like the nicest kid in the world. Like he's like he's so innocent and everybody hates him.
I think it's because he's like a super genius and he's bored with everybody. So I think he's kind of a dick to the staff. I think he is.
Well, I think I have to question the staff that he hired because they seem like morons. The scientists all seem like morons. The security guards seem like morons. I mean, when they ask for the magic word, the guy goes abracadabra. Has to be abracadabra. That's your scientist. That's like so. I think they're a bunch of idiots, and maybe they're just jealous of him.
I lost my mind at that scene. I was dying. Abracadabra. That's the magic word. Everyone knows that.
And that's a paid scientist.
Yes. Yeah. Yep.
So we talked about the timing, like Chris, you talked about like, oh, it's probably like months. So how about when he meets the dog? So he goes, he crawls through the dock because he wants to go see Bartok in zone 4. So he goes to see the dog. He takes the dog out. He pets them. Then what seems the next day, he gets his dinner. He turns so they don't see him. He puts it into a bag. He wants to bring it to the dog. Is that the next day?
I have no idea because... That was the thing too, is previously when I watched this movie, I felt like that sequence was a lot longer.
Yeah, it was a minute.
And I'm watching it. I was watching it yesterday and I'm like, oh, he knew the dog for like a day. And granted, like, you know, kids, you get latched on to like animals. I think I get latched on to any animal, but when you're a kid, I feel like you're just like, oh, that's, I love this dog now. I love this cat now. And so he's like, I think it's supposed to be a few days, but yeah, no, he fell in love with this dog and then they murder it in front of him.
We'll get to that. But I'm going to get back to the security and, you know, this is a high tech, you know, building, you know, how's this kid getting, first of all, the security guard is always sleeping. Who's on the camera.
Oh, he's horrible.
On a video. He's always sleeping. Then, you know, no one sees this kid walking around. He's able to access anywhere he wants. Like you would think that he would invest a little bit more money into the security in this whole building. And considering the guy has a teleportation pod, you can afford that, but you can't afford good security.
Their security guys rank from like sleeping on the job to like weird secret police. Like these guys, they have no boundaries. They just go wherever they want, shoot at people. Like, this is not normal.
Shoot at their own, you know.
Break into houses, looking for people.
Yeah, maybe he had a higher dummy so he can control them. Because there's some parts when he's like, don't shoot this creature. And then like a few minutes later, he's like, I'm going to shoot the creature. like within seconds. But we'll get into all that. So the dog, he sees the dog. Chris mentioned it. He's sitting there and I don't know if the dog can really see him that well, but he's like waving like, hey, hey. And the dog just like looking. The dog's like,
Could they have made that dog look any cuter, like panting, smiling, they really wanted to tug at you this part. Yeah.
That's what they wanted to do. They wanted to just screw your head up.
Oh my God.
I did like the kid's reaction though. I did like little Martin's waving.
Oh, yeah.
That's such a kid thing to do. Whether or not the dog could see him doesn't really matter. So I did like that. Yeah. And then they're like, all right, we're going to test the telepods with this beautiful golden retriever.
And, you know, I mean, and this scene, I was okay with it if it just ended right there, if it didn't include the other scene coming up. Yeah. You know, like, but again, like, I question, you're going to use a gold, like a big dog. There's so many other crappy animals out there. Like,
you know, crappy animals.
A rat.
PETA, if you're listening, no animals.
Wait, are rats on PETA's list?
I would hope so.
I think all animals are.
Even like, but like, are insects?
Yeah. Oh. I don't know, man. I don't know.
Imagine if they had a list. They're like, all right, we protect every animal except scorpions. Those things are fucking.
Ace Ventura doesn't like bats.
That is true. That made no sense.
So,
that's a whole other thing.
But Jerry Wasserman, who plays the character Sims, I think they say his name one time maybe, and he goes, oh, the dog's in there. It's moving. And then the dog jumps out, rips his hand out. And then you just see like the end of it. And that got him on the cover. His arm was on the cover of Fangoria magazine, which is like, he was so excited about that. And he was only on set for like 2 or 3 days. But for him, that was so cool. They interviewed him about the whole process of putting on the prosthetics and everything. So that was a cool scene, man. It really like really screwed you up.
Yeah.
You know, you knew something was going to happen. I never seen this movie. I didn't know what to expect. I definitely didn't expect what it looked like. I mean, that was a little disturbing itself, but yeah, that was pretty cool.
Yeah. I think they were messing with the expectations of people who had seen the first one. So when you're watching that, you're expecting the dog to just be like dead, like the baboon was in the first one. Whereas, so when it jumps out and it's a disgusting mutated blob dog and it bites the dude's like hand off, it's, you know, it's the classic 80s jump scare, you know?
Yeah.
It works. It works. Yeah. Actually, getting to the beginning of that scene, one thing that did work on me, and it's super cheesy and cliche, but when Martin comes into the observation deck and the camera picks up and aims down into the laboratory and you see the telepods for the first time. So it's the first time you're seeing it after the first movie and the music swells. I loved it. It was so great. So it's so ominous. It's like, oh, as soon as you see it, you're like, okay, these guys are gonna ruin everything with these pods because they just are. They're an idiot, you know, they're an idiotic like lab corporation that just thinks that they're gonna play God with these. And it just works. It's a perfect scene for me in this movie.
Yeah, the music was great. The soundtrack was cool. There was, you know, the setups and I liked it. Yeah, that really like set the tone for that too. So it's his fifth birthday, and this scene, given what's going on in the world, don't want to make light on it, but isn't it kind of gross now when you see somebody blow out birthday candles? Really? Nobody's ever going to do that again.
Well, I thought you were going to say something else. I thought you'd say, knowing the movie and he's only five and the other girl's dating.
There's a lot about
that. I mean, it's, I thought you'd go in that direction. I'm like, it's a little, you know, but yeah.
But she doesn't know that.
Okay, but we do.
Yeah.
Wait, so you say you're never going to blow out a candle again?
I don't know.
That's what he said.
Okay.
I'll use like an air horn or something. Yeah. So it's his fifth birthday, and it's like you think it's going to be Bartok, who's his like his dad. He goes, I know what you want, privacy. So he gives him an apartment, which I thought the apartment was like across town or something. But it was like in that building.
It's like it's on the property.
Yeah.
It's like across the way. Yeah.
Because later on, when he leaves there to get back to the lab, he's there in like 3 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
He like knocks the door down. So I'm like, how far away is this? But yeah, so he gets his own place. He gets offered a job. Things are looking good for Martin. Everything is looking swell.
And he tests the first thing. That's later on. I was going to say the phone situation, but that's way later on, right? When he tests the phone, transports.
Yeah,
phone.
That's
a little bit later.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. I have a question for
that. Oh, no, it's not that much farther. It's right after. It's pretty soon because he starts working on it by himself. He finds his dad's old tapes, so he pops them in. He's watching them, and then,
which was cool, by the way. Seeing some Jeff Goldblum in there, you know, like all clips.
That was stock footage that didn't get used for the first movie, which I really liked. So it's
awesome.
because I hate when movies, when you're watching the sequel and they just reuse the same footage. So it feels like you're just watching the movie within the movie. So it was cool to see, like, it's a totally different take. It's different dialogue, which, and then later on they use some stuff from the first movie. But I liked a lot of that extra dialogue. I was like, oh, you're getting fresh Goldblum here.
Yeah, that was cool. But so my question was then, if he did it with the phone and it worked, why didn't they try that with the phone instead of using the dog the first time?
Well, they've been trying to do organic, and then when he tests the phone, afterwards is when he tells Beth that he kind of started from the beginning.
Yeah. Right.
So they've been able to transport inanimate objects, I think, up to that point, and then they were trying organic. So he started from scratch. The phone was the first thing he transported that actually came through correctly. And then he's like, okay, now I'm going to try to move on to something organic, which is when he tries Beth's cactus.
Oh, yeah.
We went a little too far. So, what does that Beth actually do? Because the first time he meets her, she's playing with a fishing rod.
She's fishing. Yeah, she's fly fishing.
She's got one of those sweet, you know, overnight office job deals that you don't really have to do anything until someone like your supervisor walks in. But I love those. But like Martin walks in, she has no idea who he is, but she's still fishing. Like even after she sees him, she's like, "Oh, it's a fake fly, you know, for fishing." This could be her boss. Like she doesn't know this guy. Actually, I want to also touch real quickly on the fact that his name is Martin, because originally Eric Stoltz was supposed to be Marty McFly in Back to the Future. They started filming with him. Something happened. I don't remember the story. And then they brought in Michael J. Fox. So there's scenes online of him doing.
Oh, he was terrible. If you watch some of the scenes.
Yeah.
He was actually a stunt driver. I read that he was an uncredited stunt driver for Back to the Future.
So I was like watching this. And when she calls him Marty at one point, I'm like, Marty.
Marty. Awesome. Then Doc Brown breaks in. But
Is this a spinoff?
Yes. So I love when he first does the phone and makes sure it works, he calls up that one secretary receptionist voice, which you hear a bunch of times throughout the movie. Mm-hmm. She's a total bitch. Like every time towards the end, I love when he's like, I need some organic matter. And she's like, organic matter. And you hear like a really like old timey phone voice. He's like a potato, a plant, anything.
She's like, what's she saying? The guys will be back at 8 a.m.
Yes. But the cactus, it goes through. It looks like a normal cactus. She's like, oh, I got it from California. And then when it comes through, it's just like super like twisted. It looks like one of the art exhibits from Beetlejuice. Like it looks like twisted looking. So right from there, man, that I'm like, all right, this is going to be, that would tear somebody up.
She didn't look that impressed. Like she had no idea what he was working on. She walked in there. Now, if you saw someone transport something from one place to another, I think that you'd be like, you know, it's awesome. Like she was like, oh, okay. She was more concerned about the cactus than anything else.
She loved that cactus.
I would lose my mind.
Yeah. I mean, like she did not seem impressed one bit.
Yeah. Either say, wow, this is awesome. Or wow, this is scary. And then run back. Like, I'm saying, go back into my office, practice my fly fishing. But yeah. And then I think she's awesome. I think she's super cute. Obviously like she was only a couple things, but she's
It's weird. It's I wonder why she wasn't in more stuff. Maybe she chose not to be. Maybe it just wasn't working out.
Or she was just in things that just didn't land. Like some people just choose the movies that, you know, people are always working, but sometimes they're.
Well, don't forget, she was on, I think, 90210 for like a long time. So, I mean, that could have.
Ate up some years.
Maybe.
Yeah. And it ate up a lot of years of Jamie's life because he watched it every time it was on.
Well, this movie wasn't received very well, so there's that too.
Yeah, which I don't know why, but then the security guard, total creeper. He's like looking at her, and then he even says to Martin, which again, he knows Martin, I'm sure, from being in the lab and everything. Mm-hmm. And then he goes, yeah, she said, was that your girlfriend? She had nice, what does he say?
Nice ass.
Huh. Oh my God.
But he's also playing with a taser.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's 1988. You know, you could still tell people that they had a sweet ass.
So that guy, Jamie, that is a guy that's in another movie that we covered. He played the sergeant or the police chief for San Francisco in Baby Geniuses 2. The one that the kid was basically talking for. This guy plays a cop. If you look at his IMDb,
Chief, and everything.
Yeah. He's in a lot of stuff. Yeah.
The Animal. He's in The Animal. He's in a ton of movies.
I think he was in Moving Violations. I don't know if you ever saw that. That's Bill Murray's brother. I think he might have been in that as a cop.
Yeah.
Security guard. Yeah. So.
Hey, man. He does it well.
Yeah. He's got it. So then the montage comes up with the country song dancing. and then it just, they keep cutting in confused reactions from the computer. Like, he's working on the computer. She looks over at him. He makes like a frowny face. Then it's the opposite. She makes an upset face. And it just, and the music's playing. Then cutting to dancing, cutting to fishing.
So again, what does she do for a living?
I don't know what
because, because she hasn't gone to his house. She doesn't know where he lives at this point, I guess. You know, so like, what does she do? Like, she doesn't live there either, right? She has her own apartment.
Yeah, yeah. No, she's got her houseboat that we go to.
Oh, later, yeah,
but,
yeah.
But yeah, no, because she's literally, I had that too in my notes. I was like, all right, she picks up whatever job she's supposed to be doing and just becomes his lab assistant.
And has plenty of time to do whatever she wants to do there, like including dancing.
I mean, maybe he called Daddy Bartok and was like, hey, I met this girl. She doesn't really have a lot to do in her own job. Can she be my lab assistant? But I feel like that would have set up some red flags with Bartok immediately. But
because later it seems like he just does the key card on his own and gives it to her after they have like their little bit of fight. But
I think it's just bad scripting, you guys.
He forgot a page.
And to go out on a limb.
Yeah. It goes right from like, 46 to 49. They're like, where are the two pages? It's like, just shoot it, damn it. So maybe that's where the 2 months of like, dates or, but yeah, wouldn't they be walking through the hallway one day and she's like, all right, have a great night. She goes out the door. He doesn't. And he goes into like a utility closet. And
well, he gave her a hint. He's like, oh yeah, when do you sleep? He goes, I don't sleep in the morning. I work all night. I sleep at night. I don't sleep at night. Like, yeah. So he kind of told her, I don't sleep, you know, yep. Which that's the other thing. Like, why doesn't he sleep? Flies don't sleep.
I think for their body size that they probably sleep, you know, seconds at a time. They probably have like little micro naps or something. So a fly man, I don't know, it's super, it makes no sense.
Yeah, I had that question. I also had a question. I know flies eat poop, so does he eat poop?
Oh yeah.
Well, he ate cake.
Yeah,
unless there was a poop cake in there.
Could have been a poop cake.
Well, I mean, you know, there's the scene in the first one where Goldblum's throwing up on all his food and then slurping it up. He like liquefies it. Not enough of that.
There was a lot of throw up in this one too.
Yeah, not enough in this one.
So then she says, hey, my friend is having a party and he's like, a part? Oh no, get together. And he's like, a get together? And she's like, you know what a get together is, right? Where there's people there. And he's like, yeah. And then the door's closing and she's like, kind of like, whatever. Like, and she's like, are you gonna go? He's like, yeah. So then he shows up and he's just like standing in the back. And the whole time I was thinking, obviously the security guards know who he is. Scientists know how old he is and everything about him, but all the other people, no one has an idea. Like, he's 5 years old and he's part fly.
And he's never met anyone his age or looking like his age. Like, he's only seen the scientists and everything.
I think it is supposed to be that the company's just so big that he's, you know, for the first few years he was locked away basically. So only those people saw him, and now he's got a little bit more freedom, but now only a few more extended employees are seeing him, like security guards and stuff.
So that party was at the building?
It was at the building. It was a different department.
That's what I'm saying. Like, I think more people live there than we think.
But those people are all like super normal. Like, they're all like super normal, like employees. They weren't like crazy mad scientists like he's been dealing with. So they're all like looking at him like, oh, who's the new guy? Kind of, oh, that's him from, you know, he works in a different sector and he's with Beth. And so it's like very conversational that he gets that other girl looking at him as she walks by.
I know. She wanted it. She
eye fucks him. Like, yes. I was like, hold your horses, lady. He is 5 years old.
Yes. So no, a few questions I have. So it's not like we had to know that Bartok would say, hey, don't tell people because your situation is like really unique. He's smart. He understands that. But wouldn't Beth be like, so, hey, so what are you doing for work now? Yeah, I'm like teleporting these objects from here to there. And the people are like, holy shit, what are you doing? Or even him, like somebody walks up to try to make like small talk.
Yeah, they don't talk at all.
This guy's off. Yeah. This guy doesn't know anything.
Standing in the corner.
Yeah, he's 5 years old, and then he overhears the guys talking about, like, what is it, their longest living subject, 2 years old, and then that's when he sneaks in, and this is,
This is where my daughter cried.
Right here.
Yeah, are you kidding me? Like, you know, like, first of all, the whole scene is disturbing. I mean, you know, and I have so many questions. I mean, first of all, why are they keeping it alive? Is there a reason why they keep the dog alive?
For funsies, I don't know. they're the genetics lab, so they're like, oh, let's see what happens, I guess.
So she knew that the dog was there.
Beth, no.
And then why was he mad at her?
I think he's just mad at everyone.
Yeah, he like assumes everyone knows, and he's the butt of the joke kind of thing.
Okay.
And Bartok told him that they had put it to sleep to, you know, put it out of its misery, and it wasn't. And so I think it's just a well of emotions, and he's mad at everybody.
Yeah. Okay.
I thought you knew. So, but seeing that dog crawl out, my daughter starts, tell me, Dad, that's not the real, I go, it is. And then you see the dog looking at him and trying to drink the water, and the kid, it was hard to watch. It was disturbing.
Yeah. That's a hell of a dog stunt double. That dog, that dog worked hard for that part. You know how like McConaughey loses a lot of weight? That dog moved its eye to the side of its head.
Oh,
Doug, I hate to break it to you. I think it was a puppet.
It was a scary looking puppet, dude. When the one eye is all the way here and like.
But when you see the one eye, you see that the dog is still there.
Oh,
and that was rough. So, yeah. He decides to, put the dog out of its misery, right? So here's disturbing part number two. So he decides to put the dog out of his misery. That's the best way. He decides to suffocate it, like choke it out, and that's the best way to kill the dog?
I guess, I think because of how deformed it was, it wasn't getting a lot of oxygen to begin with. So he's like, all right, I'll just cup its nose and it'll just go.
But that's a horrible way to go. I mean,
what other way would it be?
I guess he didn't have access to
seen Old Yeller, drugs. Right?
Oh, you want to shoot him?
He's going to shoot it.
Well, you shoot the dog, it's over instantly. You're suffocating it. He had at least 20 seconds of, trying to breathe.
I don't know. I mean, if he didn't have access to something that would put the dog to sleep, he's not going to have access to a gun. He's going to lift it off one of the security guards as he's walking by.
What about the flight?
There's a lot of guns here.
There's a lot of guns in that building. The kid is able to get access everywhere in the whole building. I'm sure he can figure out where to get the guns. He is a genius.
That's true.
I don't know. Suffocating. It was a chloroform or whatever. I'll
be honest. I didn't watch the death scene. I actually got up and walked into the kitchen.
Did you really? It was bad.
You know what? Movies typically don't really get to me, especially when I've seen a bunch. But I was like, I don't feel like watching this. And I just walked up and I went and got a drink for the 30 seconds.
I don't mind people dying in movies. When an animal dies, I have a hard time. One of the few times I think I cried, would you ever see Project X with the monkeys?
Yeah.
Oh my, when the monkey gets stuck in that one room, I was crying. That's rough.
Yep.
Bambi, Jamie, bawling.
Rough. Rough. Well, that's any Disney movie, first of all.
Rough.
Oh.
No, so with the dog, so he just has this horrific moment with the dog. And then he thinks in the very next scene, he gives Beth, he surprises her with a kitten. She gets excited. And then he's like, let me throw this frigging thing in the teleporting thing. And that is horrific.
Yep.
Yeah, he already.
Good news. The cat lives.
Cat lives. Save the cat moment. So after he saves the cat and she looks at him and then she's like, you saved the new cat. So I'm going to give you my pussy because the next part is just so confusing because they have sex. Wouldn't he be horrible unless he studied pornography or something?
Well, he's a genius.
He is a genius.
And he's accelerated.
Yeah.
Which could be a bad thing.
All right. In and out, ladies. Let's go.
He gets really nerdy about it. He's like, okay, Beth, I'm going to stick it in a 72-degree angle and then by the xylem and the flow. And then it's like, but it was just weird. Like, they did that. And then he slept. The first time they were, when he was getting his blood drawn, he said, oh my God, I slept for 2 hours. Maybe it was because, I have this girl that I'm with. But then the next, after sex, he falls asleep again. So that's really weird for him to sleep at all.
Well, he thinks his condition's decelerating, which is why he thinks he's just able to sleep now. He thinks he's like leveling out. No, he's just getting the good at night. So
yes.
She's wearing him out. Or as the security card says later, like girls like a jackhammer.
Oh,
so grody.
It was. And just the angle when they showed the kid, the sex tape that he gave to her.
Oh,
why would he have given her the sex tape? Just the
extra level of creep.
Yeah. That was just weird.
Yeah.
Here, if you want to watch this later, you know, I had a tape over an old episode of Cheers. So, but yeah. So one thing that in the computers in these 80s movies, they're really smart. They're smarter than they really are, because in this movie,
you can have a conversation.
Yeah. He's able to type in questions about like, hey, am I able to remove the genes? And it's like, do, no, not with that. And then he asks it in a different way. And it's like, yes, but computers never worked like that, I don't think.
That was his dad's creation too.
Oh, okay.
So in the first one.
So like in the first one, the computer was able to have a conversation.
Yeah, he does. He makes it like voice activated too. He like talks to it, and I don't know, I can't remember if the computer talks or not, or if maybe just spells it out on the screen. But
you do see this a lot in 80s movies.
Oh, yeah, the numbers jumbling on the screen.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, it's working.
That's the DNA sequencing.
Yeah.
So the computer is actually smarter than the kid, because he's the one asking the question, and the computer's telling him no.
That is true. So how about his arm? Like he thought it was from the blood being drawn, and
he thought it was like an infection from the syringe.
When it starts pussing and he starts pulling it out and it's just getting swollen, dude, it's getting.
But who's pulling out like cotton? Like what was that?
That's what it looked like.
That's like it's like the cocoon webbing stuff, because eventually it starts coming like out of his face. Like when he's supposed to be like getting into the cocoon, but yeah, we'll get to that. But that's actually talking about like pacing of this movie and like how it's broken down into parts. That's one of the weird things about this movie is, so we start off with the horrific thing. Then we get the precocious kid in the lab movie. Now we're starting to slowly get back into the creepy sci-fi horror of it. And it's just, I did have issues with pacing this time around with this movie.
Well, I think they threw so much at us right off the bat that I think they had to have like a little lull in the middle, because then it gets chaotic in the end.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
So I think it was like, we just can't have a continuous chaos. So I think, I mean, the first part of it, I never seen a movie jump that fast, that hard, you know, and that gross within like 5 minutes. So I think they just needed to slow it down a little bit, because the last like half hours were ridiculous.
Yeah, and then you see him start changing, obviously, with the pus in his arm. But then when he finds out he's being watched, he starts ripping everything up in his apartment. Then he breaks into the security room. He starts just tearing everything up, and then he runs off. And then he's getting chased by the security guards. And then the one says the famous line that Chris said that I might get on a t-shirt about, girl was like a jackhammer. You see him change. You see that first time we see like a different side of Martin. And then he just tosses him through the window, and then he just runs off.
Well, I like how he says, you have to get through me first. Oh. The guy looks like he's in his 60s or maybe 50s, maybe even like late 40s. Dad bod. Like it would be one thing if you're like the Rock standing there, but the guy looks like a marshmallow.
Yeah.
You gotta get through me first, pal.
Yeah. I mean, who are you?
Yeah. And then he just runs off, and then he sneaks into Beth's houseboat. She's waiting for him with, what does she hit him with?
A bat. Was it a bat? Didn't she have like a bat or something?
I think something.
I think it was a bat.
Yeah. Although just to backtrack a second.
Yeah.
We get a little bit more of his like fly ability coming out.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. He can't get through the gate. So then he jumps onto, he jumps like over it and then like onto like another houseboat, I think. And then, and then we see him leap a good 10, 12 feet. So you're starting to see the transformation happen. I like that shot a lot, actually.
It seems like he's transforming very fast at this point.
Yeah.
Yeah. Whereas like with his father, because it was something that was a lab accident, it's a slower transformation. He's basically transforming for 90% of the movie.
Yeah.
Whereas this is, he's born this way and now it's, you know, he's been accelerated since birth. And now it's like an overnight thing. He's starting to transform.
So why doesn't he get any of these, you know, like symptoms before five?
I don't know.
It's the timeline of the half human, half fly, maybe.
Yeah, life cycle of the fly. Okay. The Brundle fly.
I mean, you would think, I mean, in reality, if a human's turning into a fly, he would have some kind of symptoms right off the bat. You know, like he had nothing until 5 years old. I was just curious.
Yeah. So did you guys, here's one thing that's pretty cool. Did you guys notice there was two like Jurassic Park references? We talked about one earlier. He says that, you know, the whole password thing, it reminded me of like Newman's character.
Yep. Yep.
And then Bartok says it a bunch of times. Instead of, you know, I can't think of the guy's name, the guy with the shotgun in Jurassic Park, clever girl. Yeah,
Muldoon.
He says clever, clever boy like three times in the movie, Bartok. And it was like the same pacing. It was like eerily similar. So maybe like Michael Crichton or whoever put the script out there for Jurassic Park, maybe they saw this movie and stole.
Was Jurassic maybe. Park around this time or no?
A few years after.
A few years later. Because, yeah. I mean, I don't remember. I know the director, Chris Wallace, did the special effects for the first movie. I didn't really look at who was doing it for this one.
He was a supervisor for it. So maybe like it was his crew, like Rick Baker has a crew that has. But no, this guy worked
on. Are they tied to like Stan Winston or any of those guys?
I don't know.
That's who went on to do Jurassic Park. But
yeah,
granted, that has nothing to do with the script.
But no, it's like Chris Wallace Inc. is a lot of things on here. But dude, this guy worked on Airplane, the original. He did Gremlins, Piranha, The Fly, the original, Return of the Jedi. So he has like some. Wow.
That makes sense with him doing this movie, because this feels like a Roger Corman movie, like a crappy B movie, just with like a slightly better script and a better budget. But it's the same idea. It's a totally different movie from the first one, really.
Well, I would say The Fly, when we see him in a little bit, looks 100 times better than Munchie.
Maybe a little, only a little.
Maybe because they didn't have to pay Dom DeLuise was able to allocate the funds the right way.
Could you imagine the fly monster being voiced by Dom DeLuise? Oh, my God.
So then Martin stays the night, right?
Yep.
Yeah, so he stays the night. When he wakes up and his face is changing, dude, he looked like Clint Howard.
Oh, my God. Sorry to Clint Howard. Jeez.
You just lost a fan. Thanks, Doug.
Oh, Clint. Well, let me interview your brother. But no. No, honestly, dude, he looked just like him. And I was like, holy shit. So then they go to the buddy's house, the father's, which I don't know if they were really friends for the first one because he was with Gina Davis.
Oh, no. No, they hate each other, which he gets to in this briefly. No,
it was the ex-boyfriend, right?
Yeah, he's like her ex-boyfriend. She meets Seth Brundle, Jeff Goldblum, and they fall in love, and the whole thing spins out of there. And then Jeff Goldblum, Brundlefly, tries to kill Stathis at the end.
Yeah.
You know, he dissolves his hand and his foot and like eats them.
So was this like a surprise cameo kind of thing? Like,
yeah. It was just like, oh, here's the one guy we got from the first movie, so he can give a little background exposition. And you know, and we see a little bit of the video footage of him talking in the beginning.
Yeah.
And I liked it, though. I think the scene works for as brief as it is.
And he had a great one line.
Oh, yes.
Cost me an arm and a leg.
Yeah, it's so good.
Oh, I'm sorry. I think you're going to say your father really bugged me.
Yeah, that's it. It's so good. His delivery is just a chef kiss.
Yes.
It's perfect.
No, he was good. And then he's like, oh, maybe I'll invite you in. When he doesn't let him in, he like opens the door a crack, slams it. And then Martin just punches over top, opens the door. He's like, all right, I should invite you in. And he's just drinking and he's just, you know, whatever, this is fine. And then he turns, he does that little 180. He goes, all right, they're going to know your car. Take my Jeep that's in the garage. And that does not look like a Jeep. That's the biggest Jeep I've ever seen.
What was it like? I don't remember now. It's like a really old Wrangler or something.
It was huge inside. Like when they showed the inside shots, it looked like the inside of like an Airstream, like almost like a.
I think it was one of those like old like safari style Jeeps that they put out like in the '80s. Yeah. Well, you know what though? The 180 does seem a little abrupt if you're just watching this movie, but he is a bit of a douchebag in the first movie. He's very manipulative and misogynistic, yeah. But there is this like sliver of good guy that you see even in that movie.
Yeah.
So it's kind of, they're just playing on that again.
Yeah. But I guess if you didn't see the first one, there's a lot of confusion with the second
sure.
one.
Sure. Oh yeah. And for people listening, you got to watch the first one. You can't just plop down and think, hey, let's watch The Fly too. You know, it makes no sense without seeing the first one.
Correct.
But it's starting to get pretty awesome because they stay at the Rest Easy Motel. The cool logo, it reminds me of like the old McDonald's, like late night menu, like half moon guy. And then the Bartok obviously has a hold on, you know, he has connections. He's able to put him on the news, like that they're escaping, and I think they said he killed someone, right? He's on the run.
Yeah.
Must have been something like that because the cops were involved because it was on the news. And then they stay in the room.
Before you get to the room, so you see this in every movie, and I don't think I've ever seen this, and I've stayed at motels before. There's always a creepy guy that lives in a back room right at the front desk coming out in pajamas, like in every mm-hmm. movie. Like now, you go to a motel, do you ever have to wake anybody up and they come out of the back room to come give you the key? Like I've never seen that before.
No,
I've never had to wake somebody up, but I've stayed at places that people are really seedy and dressed like 2 a.m, like dressed in something that no uniform, just like chilling out, like laying.
Yeah, that seedy is one thing, but it's like in these movies, they're always in the back room, like sleeping, like their bedroom is right in the back room.
Yeah. It's like those weird like mom and pop motels that I'm not sure actually exist. I guess they do.
Well, I guess with the name, the Rest Easy Motel, I think, you know, I kind of gave a little bit away.
Yeah.
I mean, the cheapest hotel I've ever stayed in was like a Motel 6 or whatever. And, you know, they just have some guy or girl behind the counter all night.
Right.
You know, you're not waking up Jed to come open up the motel room for you.
Yeah. So when he wakes up in the morning, when Martin, well, not even the morning, it's like the middle of the night. She wakes up, she looks over at him. He's kind of like looking at the fly. What do they even call them? Fly traps? Fly buzzers?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they're just, he's staring at it, like half cock sitting up, and she's like looking at him. And when she gets close, he looks like a Star Trek villain.
He does.
He has like the bulging out of his forehead.
Yeah.
It's getting serious.
The spiky hairs and stuff. Is that when he's sleeping in the bathtub? Or is that, or is he still in the bathtub?
No, he's sitting, no, I think he's sitting in the chair, on a chair on the couch.
Yeah.
It's kind of dim there, so like it's like a faded light on him.
Yeah.
I thought he looked a little like Jeff Goldblum.
Like his dad. Yeah. It's his dad.
I know. I was, you know, had a little resemblance.
Oh, that's what I wanted to bring up earlier. Jeff Goldblum, Gina Davis, their kid's not going to be Eric Stoltz. you've got two people, dark hair. Jeff Goldblum is very tan.
And Gina Davis. Tall.
And very, yeah, too tall. Well, I guess Eric Stoltz is pretty tall.
Yeah, he seems pretty tall, yeah.
But the two of them, they give birth to this redheaded kid with like bright red freckles.
Obsessive genes took over there. But no, so then Beth panics, which who wouldn't if you were with some fly guy? And she calls Bartok. They show up, they take him in, and then. Dude, then again, the creeper, the next time we see Beth, she's in a room naked,
yeah.
And they're just hosing her down, and he's just standing.
Watching. He's standing watching. Yeah.
Ugh.
With a creepy, like, smile on his face, like, just, ugh. Yeah, he's horrible.
I forget what he says there, too. He's like, good job, boys, or something like that. It's just, it's awful. I hate it. Actually, one good gross out moment we skipped over was, he pulls out his eye in the motel, and he's like, and you see the fly eye underneath. Yeah.
Yes. I wrote down the line. He says, Beth, if you stay a while, then I'll show you a magic trick you'll never forget.
Yep.
So what creepy. The hell is that? They already had sex. What other magic trick?
He's talking about transforming, but
this is the timeline. I thought they were, again, they didn't know each other that long, even if it was a few months.
Yeah.
You start seeing this, you're not going to haul ass and get out of there. Like, you start seeing what he looks like at this point, you really don't know him that well. I mean, you know, it's only been a couple months. Yeah. I think it's time to leave. Like, she's, the fact that she's like.
Well, so she does leave. She freaks out at that point.
Yeah.
Sort of. Does she go to get Bartok? Is that why Bartok
she calls on the payphone?
Right? Yeah,
she calls to them. Yeah,
just come get them. Yeah, because she's like, this shit's too much for me. I did not sign up for this.
Yeah, and then
yeah, but it took her a while to get to that point. My point is though, like he did a lot of, you know, he started looking creepy for a long time. She would have left a long time ago. So it did take her a lot to get to that point.
Well, I think in the beginning it was more of she's trying to help him.
Well, he only looked a little swollen. Like, and he didn't look that bad.
And now we're at the point of, like, his personality's changing. And he's becoming more monstrous and, like, being super creepy.
Right.
So she's like, all right, this is – he's going to turn into a monster or he's going to die or both. Let me at least call them in and they'll – maybe they'll get him to a point where he can be – you know, he can recover or so. Because she has no idea what their plans are.
Yeah, or what he's going to really turn into. She doesn't really know. It's not like he divulges any of that information to her that I can remember. But dude, then the movie just changes, and I love it, dude. When he is the cocoon, and Bartok's like talking to him, trying to get him to, like, you see his face in there, like you still see Eric Stoltz's face, and he's like talking to him. And it's funny, all these people that shitted on him, you know, it comes back to bite him. And first, the female doctor.
Ugh.
I love that scene.
So, yeah, but see, and you see this in a lot of movies. So, like, she starts seeing him, you know, come out. She's standing there in the corner, like, not running out of the room, just watching the whole thing happening. And with a frightening face. Like, I think she's, like, trying to scream or, like, like she was breathing heavy. No, she was breathing heavy, I think, or something like that. Why would you just leave? Like, why is she just standing there watching? Why do they always do that?
Frozen with fear. Frozen with fear. That's she's so horrified. She can't believe what she's seeing. And, you know, and she gets hers in the end because she's off.
I don't know. The minute I see that leg comes out, I'm out of there. I don't, it won't take long.
Oh, yeah.
No, but I love the way they revealed him in pieces. Like, you didn't see, they didn't, like, really, like, if seeing this movie, like, the first time in a movie theater, like, with a bunch of people in the dark, that would have been, like, such a cool moment because you see a little bit, you really just see her just get, like, knocked into the wall. And then when they come in later, they're like, hey, where's the doc? And they look up and she's, what's his name again? The other doctor?
Oh, Dr. Shepherd.
Shepherd walks in, he's looking for her. He has, like, his, he has his thing. He's writing down. He looks up, and then she's there, just like impaled onto the ceiling.
Well, you know what it is? The first movie, you don't really see a fly, right? Like, Jeff Goldblum looks all creepy and deformed, but he doesn't turn into an actual fly, does he?
Not till like the very end.
Oh, so he does turn into an actual fly, like you see him, like Eric Stoltz did?
Yeah, he looks more fly-like than Eric Stoltz does. This is like crazy wild big monster thing. There's some characteristics that they brought over, but Jeff Goldblum's face in the first one, at the very end when he's fully transformed, like all his human skin is sloughed off and everything, he looks more fly-like. He's got the little mouth thing going. And
does his voice get really high?
Oh, no, at that point he can't talk anymore.
Isn't that how they always do, like the voice of a fly, like
yeah.
But actually I wanted to bring up Dr. Shepherd because that guy he's played by like Frank C. Turner. That guy, like the guy who gets his hand bitten off, he's in 200 things too, and most people probably know him. He was in the 1990 It miniseries. He plays the abusive father to Bev in that. So like, but when he pops up and stuff, like, you know him, he's got that.
Oh, he's that creep.
He's that creep. Yeah. He's got, and just, he's got that thin face. He always looks like shocked or pissed.
Well, yeah, he definitely had a shocking face going down the stairs, that whole like sequence.
But I'm sure not one of his credits is he a likable character.
He kind of looks like him and Jerry Wasserman kind of look like. If you look at their photos from like around that time, they kind of look like the same guy. When I first started watching it, just before I interviewed him, I'm like, I thought it was him. And then I found this other clip that had his name attached to it. I'm like, oh, that's him. But they kind of like have like that. They kind of look like, if you like, while you're watching it, like they could be like brothers.
Yeah, maybe look.
Be saying all white guys look alike or something.
Yo.
Yo. But Yeah. So then Bartok, which is really cool. Not Bartok, Shepard, when the fly finally confronts him and he grabs him by the tie and he's dragging around the hallway. It's kind of like from earlier in the movie when he was a kid, he would, when they showed the one security footage, he was dragging Dr. Shepard around the room when he was a little kid by his tie and just pulling him around.
Oh, yeah.
So he's kind of doing the same thing.
Yep.
A few other things like that come up. But dude, I think he looks so cool. I love it.
Yeah, the creature design?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. I do like it. I like that they didn't just try to do the same thing as the first movie. But yeah, they go all alien on this. It's just a big hulking monster. You know, it's going to murder everybody.
Well, I think, you know, in the first one, you really didn't see what the fly could do. You know, I mean, like he had like little moments of, you know, breaking the guy's wrist or spinning, but like here is like he's the fly. Like, you know, he's a man fly, you know, and it was, I think the whole last like 15 minutes was awesome.
But he loved the dog. The Rottweiler.
I was a little nervous at that. I mean, you know, just because you don't know what, you know, again, never seen the movie before. I didn't know if he was still part in there.
Yeah.
And then when the dog comes over, my daughter's sitting there, he goes, no, don't tell me. I don't know. And then he let the dog live.
He petted. You just saw like the POV of him, the dog, and then you just see the little.
Oh, so you know that his little Martin's still in there.
I love the scene of him petting the dog with a big fly hand. Yeah. It's so good. Well, and then he has a similar moment with Beth. You know.
Yep.
When he sees her,
he looks her right in the face, and he's like, oh, okay.
Wasn't there a point maybe it was at the end when she kisses him, but all like the gook and.
That was the thing. I was like, did she kiss him or did she, or they like touch foreheads?
No. There was a kiss involved.
Okay.
There was slime.
I don't get it.
You hear that smack going?
That would be scary. Wouldn't you worry? Like, you don't know what this guy is. You just found out what he was.
Well, wouldn't you also be worried that maybe you're pregnant?
Yeah. Well, maybe he's protection.
Yeah.
It was the late 80s.
Yeah.
That is true. I like how Bartok says, all right, I don't want him harmed or killed, and they're running around with machine guns.
I know. Stocked up. It was after he said that, then all of them all grabbed machine guns. It was so like,
what do they think they're going to do with him?
I know.
Yeah. I love too, because he's so adamant about not hurting or killing him. And then at the end, when everyone's dead, he's like, all right. I'm sorry I came to this, but now I have to kill you.
Yeah.
So you just did a 180. Like,
oh, he had to protect himself, but yeah, he's a creep. So I like that buzz noise too that Eric Roberts had. Eric Stoltz, Eric Roberts. Yeah.
Eric Roberts would have been great in this role.
But he had a buzzing like fly sound when he was around, like loud.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. No, the effects are so awesome. I love the security guard that's looking for him, and then he sprays the acid all over his face, and then you just see him like screaming. And then when you see him again, and it's just like, it's just barely,
it looked
barely
like
ahead.
It reminded me of RoboCop when the guy was melting.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. I think that holds up as one of the best effects in any movie.
Oh.
Cause he sprays him with the acidic vomit, melts his face. You're watching the guy's face melt in real time.
Yeah.
He falls to the ground. The guy's still screaming. You're seeing the breath come out.
Yeah.
Now, one, that guy would not be alive. He would just die from immediate shock. But then the other security guard comes over to comfort him.
Yes.
And like takes him by the hand, is like, you look okay, buddy. Like, you're going to be all right. The guy's face and hand and legs are like gone.
Yeah.
Because when they do they pull back, because you think it's just his face. Then you see his hands melting off. His feet are like melting off. You're like, just shoot the guy.
Yeah, put him out. And then even the next scene when one of the security guards gets close to the fly, he gets tossed under the elevator that happened to be going down.
Yes.
And dude, that looked awesome too.
Yeah.
Dude, his head exploding, getting crushed, it looked good, man.
So then how come when the creepy security guard had it on his hand, he only had like a few like
little marks?
Yeah.
Wasn't enough, I guess.
No, and I honestly think his death was not good enough. Like he needs something. He needs something.
Yeah, he deserved worse.
He deserved a lot worse.
He should have had the face melting.
Yeah, 100%.
That should have been the climax of the movie with him.
Yeah.
He kind of let him off easy, like just crack. Not easy, but he cracked his back and like fold him into a pretzel.
Folds him over.
Yeah, drops him onto the ground, and then it's the showdown. just one-on-one. And then he knew that, you know, that he had that gun on him. He grabs it, he points it at him, and you almost thought like he was going to, there's not much human to him, only the fact that he's very manipulative. And he said, call me dad. And mm-hmm. he was just a subject the whole time for his experiment. But for a second, I was like, maybe he's just going to let him live, because obviously not. He fires a shot right into him pretty quick. First, he stuns Beth with a taser after she tries to help.
I don't think a taser works that way.
It doesn't fly?
The fly and like and pass out within 2 seconds. Like it was like a little quicker shot.
They like slammed her against the wall.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're getting to the end here, but going back, to get to the end, Martin finds out how to cure himself of being a fly man.
Yep.
And he doesn't want to do it.
He didn't want to sacrifice anyone else, because he said to the Stathis when they were at the house, he's like, you know how to do this, don't you? You got to do it. And he is like, no, I don't want to take another life in order to save my own. And then he has to get to the point, like, come on, this guy, Bartok, has no reason. He shouldn't be living at all for what he's done. And that was a really cool scene, because when they go into the telepod, then go to the next one, and when they come out, it looked like Human Centipede. It looked just like it.
I never saw that movie, but
it was like Human Centipede mixed with like old porridge.
So, but now when they transported a human, didn't they have to have no clothes on?
Yeah, I did think about that too. Because
I was thinking about that. Why is like it's like so? The transportation really it shouldn't have happened. It shouldn't have worked because he was fully clothed.
Yeah,
Bartok.
So, did you want to see Bartok fully nude?
We don't know what
you didn't want him.
We don't know what Martin did with the computer. We know we know he has it like set up, so maybe he just knows. Hey, or I'm gonna have to drag someone in here with me.
Yeah.
Or they could have said, you know what? The audience has seen a lot of gross things. We don't need to see Bartok naked.
Yeah,
that would be like over the top.
Big Daddy Bartok.
And then even to show the emotional attachment, even though he knows this guy is using him as an experiment, it like kind of tugged at you a little bit when he had him in there. And to start the sequencing, he uses his fly hand, he puts it down, and it's D-A-D, dad.
Yep.
So it was like right in front of him the whole time. And yeah, dude, when he comes out normal, that was, and not saying it wasn't surprising, because that's like the ending, the happy ending that could happen for a science fiction movie. But God, she kisses him. Why?
She's just so in love with her boyfriend of 3 months, who's a monster
and 5 years old. That is the part I can't get over.
Again, she doesn't know that. She doesn't know that.
Yeah.
Actually,
she didn't know that.
So I feel like that. So that's like the last time we see them. And then we get another beat, which we'll get to in a minute.
But
that's the last time we see them. I feel like there should have been a couple more minutes tacked on at the end.
There is a deleted ending. Ending.
I feel like they needed some closure. And maybe I saw that deleted scene because I felt like there was a scene that I knew about that was missing.
The sort of deleted scene basically has them, I think, by the houseboat or somewhere, looking out, and she walks over to him and says, you know, how are you feeling? Is everything okay? And like he hugs her, and then the camera zooms on his face, and he looks at the camera and he goes, yes, everything's okay. And then it zooms out. Like, so you see his eyes and, you know, kind of like hinting maybe everything's not okay.
Oh, I thought it was going to be like more like, I think you're going to say like she was pregnant. Yeah, like attached. She's like, Martin, come here. Look at, and then fly three.
I do like that this gets a happy ending, because the end of the first one is so bleak.
Ugh.
And which I feel like it has to be. The movie from start to finish is bleak, but this is like it's the hokey happy ending 80s movie. But you know.
But Bartok as that creature, like the dog, sludging out like army crawling to get to
that,
the food.
See, I love that.
But it was like such a, and then the very end of the movie is just a zoom in on the food dish.
Yeah,
and it has the fly credits roll on it. Like you're watching the names of the most important people. Not about the most important, but more like the directors and producers on there. It's pretty like
It's
happy.
It's happy, but it's very disturbing.
It's a roller coaster of an ending. It's happy, and then all of a sudden, it's as unapologetic as you can get with a villain's ending.
Yep.
So that was Fly 2. We'll go to our guests first. So, Chris, would you recommend Fly 2?
I would. You definitely have to watch the first one, as I said. It doesn't have that great sci-fi horror artistry that the original has, because you had David Cronenberg, the master of body horror, on that movie. But for making a somewhat sillier monster movie that does still have some of the heartbreaking moments that the first one has, it's a solid sequel. I think it's been harshly judged over the years, but
agreed.
There's fans out there. I've talked to them. I've talked to them. They're out there.
All right, Jamie, are you one of those fans?
Yeah, I'd never seen the movie before. I remember seeing The Fly many times, loved it. And I think this is a good follow-up. It's definitely not as good as the first one. You have Gina Davis and Jeff Goldblum. So you can, two top actors. But it was good. It was entertaining. It was a typical 80s, had an 80s feel to it. But I think the storyline, once you understand what's going on, especially after seeing the first one, I think it's a good follow-up. Because you really don't want a repeat of the first one. And they kind of took this in a big different direction. So I think it was definitely worth watching.
Yeah, I love the creature effects. And I love that it felt like an 80s movie.
Yeah.
Like the rom-com feel, the kiddie part of it. So there's like so many different things put into it. And solid sequel. So that's it for Fly 2. Next movie that we're going to be covering is probably one of the most insane movies we may cover, because it looks crazy. Never even heard of it at all until I was lucky enough to interview somebody that I didn't even know was in a sequel until like mid conversation, because in the email she was like, oh, I was never in any sequel. So I didn't even really like look. And it's at the very top. It's like one of her last movies she's done. It's Samurai Cop 2, Deadly Vengeance, which has, Tommy Wiseau as the bad guy in the movie. And I interviewed Kristine Debell. She was in so many things in the 70s and the 80s, then took some time off to raise a family, but she was in Meatballs. She was AL in that. She was the first on-screen boyfriend of Jackie Chan in Battle Creek Brawl. And Blood Brothers, she was the first on-screen boyfriend of Richard Gere. So nice. She has some cool stories about her career. Really awesome Bill Murray story. So check that out. And Samurai Cop 2, I'll remind you guys next week, but you can watch that for free on Tubi and Vudu. But yeah, so that's it. Don't forget to review, rate, share our podcast. Follow us on all social media at Sequels Only. And check out our new website, sequelsonly.com. Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Good night.